Students, it is our last lecture of first week, and we will now understand the Kirchhoff's laws in the frequency domain. As we know, in the Kirchhoff's law, that's the voltage drop in a particular circuit, series circuit, all the summation of the voltage drop is equal to the source of the circuit. And if we just adding up the source voltages, the voltage drops, we will get the source voltages. And for KVL, let V1, V2, Vn, Vn be the voltages around a closed loop. Then we can find out V1 plus V2 plus V3 and up to Vn is equal to 0. And that is the frequency domain representation inside the below the page. We can get it, and after that we will go down to it and get this. This can be written as like this. It's real parts, and after taking the real parts, e to the power j omega t is common, taking the common, and because we know that e to the power j omega t can't be zero, so the phasor values will also be zero, indicating that Kirchhoff's voltage law holds for phasors too. So that is similar to the DC voltages. Also, we can convert it to the Kirchhoff's current law, as we know that Kirchhoff's current law holds for phasors too. If I1, I2, I3 and In be the current leaving or entering a closed surface network at a time, then we can find out that adding up all the currents will be zero. And if I1, I2 and to the up to In are phasor forms of the sinusoids I1, I2, In, then we can find out this too. Once we have shown both KVL and KCL hold in the frequency domain, now the impedance combinations. That is a series circuit. We can see here there is a voltage, source voltage, Z1, Z2, up to Zn are the impedances. There are n impedance, and each impedance holds voltage V1, V2, voltage drops V2 up to Vn, and there is a single current I. So we can apply KVL around the loop as it is given and get the J equivalent V by I. And you can also see the input terminals Z1 plus Z2 up to Zn, Z equivalent. That means in series circuit it is similar to the DC circuits or in resistances that we used previously. Keep on in mind while you are doing the mathematics that in the previous DC operations R1 and R2 put Z1 and Z2 on the place of R1 and R2. That means just you have to take Z1 and Z2, that means impedances, in the place of resistances. Same here, we can find out the current through this Z1 plus Z2, that is total Z in a series circuit, total impedance, similar in the DC circuit. Just replace these things. Just replace R1, R2 to Z1 and Z2. And you know Z1 and Z2 means that is resistance and reactance, both are in operation. You can also find out the voltage drops from it. You can also find out the voltage drop from it, and that is V1 and V2. That is voltage divider law, that is voltage division relationship. The reactance of that voltage divided by the total impedance of the voltage divided by the total impedance into total voltage. We can find out voltage division relationship, and applying Kirchhoff's current law we can also find out there is the in parallel connections. As we know, in parallel connection there are the current will be divided into two, three or many n impedances in parallel, and voltage remains same. So there is a current source here given, it's known as current source, and we can also find out from this the current, that is the total current. Total current has been divided by I1, I2 and I up to IN, and from this we can also calculate this, that is the current division principle. In current division principle, you have to keep on your mind that the voltage is not changing. Voltage is similar in all the Zs, but the current has been different. If you want to find out I1, current I1, you can easily write down Z2 divided by Z1 plus Z2 into I. I means total current, Z1 is Z2, so it is two parallel. If it is two parallel impedances are working here, so the total impedance, just put on total impedance same as before, and the opposite impedance, that is the difference between the voltage division law and current division law. In voltage division law, the voltage across the same impedance will be multiplied here, but in current division law, if you want to find out I1, you have to give the opposite impedance multiplied to the total current divided by the total impedance. Same as here, if you want to find out I2 in the opposite branch, that resides Z1, so you have to calculate through Z1 and multiply with the total current I. And there is a delta Y connections too. You know better delta Y connections. There are similar results as before we have studied in the DC supply. Same as here, same theorems are there. If Y to delta conversion, just keep a screenshot and study how to convert from Y to delta. If it is a Y, that you have to convert it to the delta. Delta means the A, B and C. Just multiply these things, Z1, Z2, Z2, Z3, plus Z3, Z1, divided by the opposite impedance, that's Z1. You can find out the Za, so Z1. So if it is Zc, so it will be Z3. If it is Z2, it will be Zb divided by. But the factors are similar in the numerical, not denominator, in the numerator upwards. And if you want to convert delta to Y, similarly this equation follows, Z1 and Z2. That means just get back onto the circuit. If it is Z1, if you want to find out the other two parts, Za, Zb, Zc will be multiplied and divided by the all additional Za, Zb, Za plus Zb plus Zd. All the impedance should be additive here, summed up. Okay, if it is Z1, so the two parts of the connected impedances Zb and Zc will be multiplied. After that, if a Y delta or Y circuit is said to be balanced, if it has equal impedance in all three branches, if it's all equal impedances, so the relationships come like this. Now we have to focus some calculations, some examples, how to calculate these impedances from it. We will discuss into the next video. Thank you very much.